Boys, hey girls. Today we're gonna do two things. We're gonna refurbish my Char-Broil. I bought a new burner and a new vaporizer plate for it. Here's our new vaporizer bar. Way more heavy duty. And it's one piece. And here's a new burner. All one piece. It don't have them little flexible bullshits. And it come with a new igniter. The universal one don't come with no new igniter. I just been lighting it with one of them extended lighter matches thingies. You know, the snap deals. Propane lighter. Let's go fix this grill. So the first thing we're gonna do is remove our cooking grate. Our old vaporizer bar. And this is what the charcoal tray sits on. I just had them down in there. If you want to clean it out, do so. I've removed the clips on the end of the burner tubes where they attach to the manifold. So now we can simply slip it off. And you can see where it was all rusted out and leaking down here, and had some feet on it that fell slap off. See? And this was the original charcoal grate rest supports. It went across here on these clips. Something like that. Yeah, there you go. Charcoal grate would sit on top of them. I made some new one out of stainless tubing. So, if you're gonna clean it up, do it. If not, don't worry about it. So we're gonna slip our new burner in place, and it's gotta engage up underneath on the manifold ends down in here. But before we do that, we're gonna test the spark lighter right here. Here's this wire right there. Let me test that. Put you down. Oh, you son of a bitch! Spark lighter is working. Damn it, boy. That kind of stung. My arm is numb now. Shit. All right, so we're gonna plug it in. Don't do that at home, folks. I was having a stupid attack. Damn. Don't hold that wire. It hit good. And now we gotta get these clips. Got two of them, and they lock in place on this burner to keep it from sliding out. And I got to get down underneath there to do that. So I'll take y'all be able to see after. Stand by. So let's see what we got. Turn the gas on. Ignition. There we go. New burners, all lit and happy. All you gotta do is put that vaporizer bar on there. Turn the fire off before we do that, though. Set him right in place. You gotta kinda tweak the tabs. It ain't never been on here yet. Just shove it down in place. And put the grate back on, you ready to cook. How about that? And go. Lit. Clean your grates up now. Yeah, here's that charcoal tray. And these handles fit down in a little chicken shit slot area that I done bent up a little bit in there. And they had them on each side where you put the warming tray, which is hanging on back the pit back there. And you put your charcoals in there. Now it's warped because it gets hot.
charcoal's hot. You build a fire on one side, you got your cool side over there. How about that? Let's shut this down so it'll clean those grates. I also had to add this little bracket right here because the screw rusted out up underneath there, or the piece of metal did, and that little copper bracket that's made to strap half-inch copper tubing in construction work, and it's easy to bend like I need it for it to fit there. And the reason this side broke is from pushing on that spark igniter. The other side's still intact, as you can see up in there.
We're going to talk about grilling. Being as 4th of July is coming up, Father's Day is coming up, and first let me state that I've been grilling since 1970. Used to help Dad grill steaks and burgers, and one mistake that he used to make, and I didn't think nothing of it back then, was he used lighter fluid. Boo. I've been got my first smoker in 1976, my first grill in 1974, and first thing I do is I read the manual, and look, I still got my first grill, char kettle, my first smoker, Big Boy by Kelly. It's the assembly instructions. Here's the owner's manual, and it actually has, they had several different models. Single cooking grate, double cooking grate, triple cooking grate. So it had inserts that went in them, depending on which one you bought. So you could get it with three cooking levels if you wanted to. I've got my quick set combination charcoal gas grill. I've got Oklahoma Joe's, Weber Smoky Mountain. And I got another one out there that didn't really come with a manual. It just had some assembly instructions. It's a charcoal grill. So, cut. Like with all of these manuals, aside from the assembly instructions, in the book, it tells you how to care for it, how to use it. And they have recipes in there too, from the people who made the damn thing. I know a lot of you probably hadn't read that. You've got a Weber Smoky Mountain and you ain't read your owner's manual, because you asked any questions that are in here answered. And look what it says: do not discard. This document contains important product information, warnings, and caution. Do not operate the smoker until you have read this guide. If you bought it secondhand and it didn't come with this, go online to the manufacturer's site and you can download it. Duh. Huh? No shit. So, what are some common grilling tips? I've already done something on smoking. Let's talk about grilling. Mistake. Here's 12 mistakes that many of you may be doing, many of you may not. And I got this off of a website, Serious Eats, and they've got all kind of cool tips, tricks. I'll put a link to this article in the description box of this video. Mistake number one, you're using lighter fluid or match light charcoals. Big time fail. Don't do that. Fumes get into your meat. You may have grew up with that. But let's graduate. Let's move on. Mistake number two, you spread your coals before they were fully gray. Okay. Don't do that. They ain't finished igniting yet. It's going to be inconsistencies in spots on your cooking area. You didn't preheat your grill. you got to do that. You forgot to clean your damn grates. Them stuck-on food pieces and shit are like little magnets. They're clean, they're sterile. Because of the fire and burnt all of the bad germs out of them. But they're like little magnets. So when you put your new food on there, the raw food, it's going to stick to it. Got to get that crapola off. It ain't flavor crystals, folks. Sorry. You're using too much direct heat. Yeah, this is going to go on into a couple of other mistakes, but too much direct heat. It's best to build a two-zone fire. Like two layers of coal for super sear, super high temp. Once you get a little sear on it or whatever, or you want to reverse sear it, for instance, you can put it on the cool side of the grill until it reaches the close to the desired temperature you want it at, let's say 10 degrees below your ideal temperature. For rare, it'd be 120. So at 110, you'd want to take it off the cool side and then sear the hell out of it till it hits 120, pull it off. You can also put a few coals in the middle, like for doing delicate things like fish. Have a super high, two layer, one layer, no layer, if your grill is big enough, right? Another thing that a lot of folks screw up with, you keep dicking with the lid. Is it done yet? Are we there yet? Is it ready yet? Every time you do that, on a gas grill, you're losing heat. On a charcoal grill, you add more fuel in for the fire, so it gets hotter. Gas grill gets colder, charcoal grill gets hotter. So you're inconsistent in your cooking temperature, like sailing a boat over the ocean. Ooh, toot toot. Don't do that. Okay, another mistake is you think awesome looking flames make awesome tasting meat. Burn it to a damn crisp. So you don't want it flaming like Kelvin's. You don't want that. Ain't good for your grill either. That damn steel down by the firebox or the metal will be dull cherry red or dull red if you notice it at night. That's too hot. Too hot in a hot tub. Mistake number 8. You think the vents are there for decoration. No. You can align them a certain way to force the convection towards the meat, or the smoke towards the meat, and out the vent on the other side. If you got them. You're adding barbecue sauce too early. Tomato product and sugars in barbecue sauce will burn. You want to put that in after you remove it from direct heat, if you're going to use barbecue sauce at all. And you got it over on the cool side. Don't think but keep adding more sauce and more sauce. It's going to soak into that meat, because it's not. Forget that. As a muscle cooks, it's like wringing water out of a sponge. Liquid comes out. You ain't going to force nothing inside that muscle unless you inject it to begin with. And then it's going to force that out as that muscle contracts also. Sorry, I ain't told meat what to do with itself. That's the way it works. Any kind of protein, it does that. Mistake number 10. You're cooking too many things at once. Some things don't take as long to cook as others. Thick steaks take longer to cook than a burger. Chicken takes longer to cook than a hunk of sausage, for instance. So you do yourself and your friends and guests a favor. Focus on one thing. Okay, let's do the burgers. Boom, we got them all. Let's do a steak. Got them all. Let's do the sausage. Got them all. Let's do the veggies. You keep all that stuff warm in your oven inside on low, 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 tinted in foil. Make a pup tin. You're poking your meat to see if it's done. Okay? Remember me showing y'all the little finger method where this is well done, this is rare or medium rare? It works on my fat finger. I know what I'm doing. I've been doing it a long time. Probably grilled over 1,000 steaks or more. You see people in restaurants, they can tell by the touch. You also got to know different cuts of meat are going to have a different feel to them depending on what part of the muscle you're poking at. Everybody's hand is different too, like I just mentioned. So you need to get an instant read. Don't worry about, oh look, the meat going to bleed to death. When you go to the doctor and get you a flu shot, do you leak all your fluids out? Gonna lose a little bit, but it ain't enough to worry about. There's plenty more in there. You can think of a hunk of meat. There's a whole bunch of straws. I've showed this before. Way more than what I got here. So when you poke a meat thermometer in there, you may only puncture one of them straws. And maybe 10,000 in a steak like that. That's when you see the grain running through that meat. That's all them little straws with the liquid in it. So you may only burst one or two, but you ain't gonna deflate the whole damn thing like a balloon. Trust me, boy. That's the way it is. I ain't write the rules. Get an instant read. Thermopen makes a good one. It's not too expensive. Oh, don't whine about how much it costs. How much meat did you waste by overcooking it? Go figure. Next thing is you're serving your meat too soon. You're not letting it rest long enough. I've done it before too. What happens is when you cook that meat, boy, it gets all hyperactive and and shrinks up and all the juices just wanting to skeet out of it. By letting it rest, it relaxes. And the juices and everything kind of calms down. And then when you cut it, you're going to lose minimum amount of juice. You're going to lose something, but you're not going to have it just skeet stuff everywhere. So I've done it. Like I said, everybody makes mistakes. Here's one more mistake. It's not mentioned in that article. Because they do go into more detail than what I did. I think that's a must read for anybody that's starting out in grilling, even the old timers. If you've been grilling for all your life like me, it's a good idea to refresh every now and then. We tend to forget, especially when we get old. That 13th tip is putting a rub that's got a good bit of sugar in it on something that you're going to grill when that rub is specifically made for smoking. That sugar is going to caramelize and burn. So you got to know your rub. And on my rub, it says on the damn bottle, it's made for smoking under 300 degrees. Don't grill with it. If you do, just stay stupid. You can grill with it and then sprinkle some on while the meat's resting, if you would so like to do that. Let me add too, I get a lot of questions about this on smoking. Fat side up, fat side down. I like fat side up. I think the fat that will melt off the meat, it helps baste the meat. If it's fat side down, the fat based in the meat is different from you spraying water on the meat. Fat actually helps meat to brown. If you've got water on it, meat can't brown with water. or juice, or say apple juice or whatever, that's got to vaporize or evaporate off before the browning process can begin on any meat. That's why they say to pat your steaks dry before you try to grill them. But like on a smoker, on a brisket, when you buy the brisket, you paid for the fat, number one. You just soon use it for some. If you do want to cut some off, cut it off and either render it down in a frying pan on medium-low heat and save it, mix it 50-50 with cooking oil to make French fries or something in. Very flavorful. It's called, It's called beef tallow. You can make it yourself. And it'll store fine in the refrigerator, like in a mason jar with a tight-fitting lid. It's going to get solid, though, and you just be like shortening at that point. So, yes, you can do that with it. You can also just leave it on there and smoke it and then cut some off after the fact. Then you've got some smoked fat. You can freeze it and put it in beans or whatever. Very flavorful. Almost like using bacon. You paid for it, you soon use it. For something. Wouldn't look good on your hat. You soon eat it. Flavorful, trust me. Now on my charcoal gas grill, made by Char-Broil, I'm going to take a picture of it in the owner's manual, because I modified the charcoal tray that you use for charcoal, because it originally had these handles that mounted on each side of the tray, and you would put the warming rack at two levels, and your charcoal was down here in this tray. So you had two grate levels, but it was only the warming tray. The main grate wouldn't fit on this. So I whacked that portion off to where I could just put the main grate down, right down on top of it, and it actually dropped the main grate down a little closer to the coals. Which is better for grilling anyway. You're going to make two zones, right? Hot, cold side. But you had more cooking surface. And I'll show you how it is now after the modification. There is a picture of it down here. I'll take a snapshot of it in the owner's manual as it came originally with these things that would come off in little handles, I guess, and they would fold down for storage. Whatever. They don't make this one no more. But I will show and tell that while we're outside refurbishing this grill that needs a new burner bar, a new burner assembly, and vaporizer plate. Because I replaced it with something that cheap universal model. It ain't last worth a shit. And I went through two of them, both of them, when I should have just went back Char-Broil for a couple dollars more and got the original equipment, more heavy duty. The original shit lasts for about 4 years in humid climate down here. This aftermarket universal stuff, you're lucky to get a year out of it. Maybe two, if you take good care of it.